Welcome to another National Security College public seminar. I'm Roger Bradbury. I'm the Director of Research at the College, and I'd especially like to welcome the diplomatic community and some of the public service that are here, and as well as students. This is going to be a very interesting evening. As a sometime marine scientist, I'm always fascinated by the fact that we've got a two-ocean navy, but we've actually got three oceans, and one that we don't look after. It's almost as if, were we in America, we weren't worrying about the patch of ocean, the sea lines of communication, between, say, California and Hawaii, or California and Alaska. So we've got an oceans problem. And then, as a person who likes, very interested in climate change, we have to our south, as part of our territory, one of the great engines and drivers of climate change, the thing that moderates and also accelerates changes in the world's climate, the Antarctic continent. That's something we don't think about as part of, as one of our problems, one of our territorial problems, quite enough. And then, as a person who's interested in strategic affairs and international relations, I'm interested that a lot of our strategic analysts look north to some of the conflicts and troubles a fair way away, in the South China Sea perhaps, or in the North Korean Peninsula. And yet, next to our territory, our territorial neighbours have overlapping territorial claims. We have a whole bunch of claimant states butting up against us in our territory of Antarctica, and we don't pay that nearly enough attention. So, Antarctica as a strategic issue is a very important issue, and we've got someone who has experience nonpareil to talk about it with us tonight. Tony Press was former director of the Australian Antarctic Division and a former head of the Antarctic CRC. He's going to talk about our strategic interests in that part of the world tonight. And after the talk, we'll do our usual Q&A. And I should remind you that the talks are being videoed, so you'll be able to see them or tell your colleagues about them afterwards, and they can refresh themselves with the proceedings tonight. So I'd like to hand over to Tony, please.
Thank you for coming. It's I know a fair smattering of people in the audience, but there are many I don't know. So I hope you all find this at least a little bit interesting. I've just finished a major report for the government on Australia's Antarctic interests, which gave me, besides far too much work to do, it also gave me a concentrated piece of time in which I was able to go back through our historical, political, and scientific engagement in Antarctica and put it in perspective. And what I want to do tonight is to give you that perspective about Australia's engagement in the Antarctic, historical, scientific, political, and cultural to a certain extent. And then touch on some of the issues that are emerging in the Antarctic sphere and why the ultimate conclusion of my recent report to the government is that Australia should reassert publicly its Antarctic interests and should be very forthright about our engagement in Antarctica and why we are there and why it's important for Australia. Roger talked about being a free ocean nation? Well, Australia has the third largest marine jurisdiction in the world, not counting Antarctica. So if you discount Antarctica, Australia still has the third largest marine jurisdiction in the world. It has the largest extended continental shelf in the world, and a third of our marine jurisdiction lies below Australian mainland. So we have a huge area of responsibility to our south, and we've had that interest and that responsibility for over a century, even predating Douglas Mawson's epic, heroic era adventures of science and exploration in Antarctica. The first Australian to land on the Antarctic continent did so 1898, Tasmanian, which is always a good thing. Australia's engagement has been in both science, exploration, discovery, and possession since that period of time. Douglas Mawson in 1911, although he never had letters patent from the Crown, on his own initiative, claimed Antarctica for the British Empire and her dominions beyond the sea. And then again in 1928, with letters patent, formally claimed parts of East Antarctica for Australia. The first comprehensive map ever made of Antarctica, that's it there, 1939, showing the Australian Antarctic Territory, the Norwegian claim, the Terre d'Ile, and the Ross Sea Dependency, which is now New Zealand, and and the UK claim in the Weddell Sea, was produced here in Canberra by the Surveyor General in 1939, and it was the first comprehensive map of Antarctica, and it shows the Australian Antarctic Territory, which is, for those who are interested, and I know Roger's interested in maps, it's the size of Australia minus Queensland. So that's how much, how big Antarctica is. The Australian claim to Antarctica is 42% of the Antarctic continent. Prior to the Second World War, the era of Antarctic exploration was really about discovery. It was also about resource exploitation, whaling in particular, also sealing. But after the Second World War, there was a strategic interest emerging in the Antarctic, particularly the interplay between the Soviet Union and the US and the Western allies being very concerned about the Soviet Union's interests in the Antarctic. And from that period, from the end of the Second World War through to about 1956, 57, there were a number of initiatives kicked off about how to deal with what was called the problem of Antarctica. And the problem of Antarctica was this emerging Cold War feeling of competition between the US and Russia, the Soviet Union, in Antarctica. The interests of the claimants, so the claimants being Australia, New Zealand, France, Norway, the United Kingdom, Argentina, and Chile, and their interests, and then this emerging interest in Antarctica from the Russians. And it wasn't until the mid-1950s that a clear way forward of how to think about how the problem of Antarctica might be solved started to emerge. And it actually emerged through a science initiative. And 1957, 1958, the International Geophysical Year, where the ICSU, the International Union of Science Organizations, got together to launch the International Geophysical Year. And their one of their grand projects was to look at the geophysical environment of the poles, and Antarctica being one of them. And 12 countries engaged in that activity, including Russia, all the claimants, and the United States. And it was from that initiative that the Antarctic Treaty, which was signed in 1960, came into force 1961, which is where the Antarctic Treaty originated. Now, I just want to concentrate here a bit on the claims to Antarctica. You can see that below the Antarctic, below Argentina and Chile, along the Antarctic Peninsula, there are three overlapping claims. They're the claims of the United Kingdom, Chile, and Argentina. All of the other claims in Antarctica are non-overlapping, and they are from here around New Zealand, Australia, France, Australia again, and Norway. So 12 countries participated in the International Geophysical Year, and they're the first 12 countries you can see on that list, and they are the countries, the original signatories to the Antarctic Treaty: Australia, Argentina, Belgium, Chile, France, Japan, New Zealand, Norway, Soviet Union, as it was at the time, Russia now, South Africa, the United States, the United Kingdom. They're the original signatories to the Antarctic Treaty. So back in the 1959, 1960, when the Antarctic Treaty was being negotiated, 12 countries had direct interests in the Antarctic. Since then, all of those countries on the left, there, the orange countries, have all joined the Antarctic Treaty and have active Antarctic programs. All of those countries in this row are signatories to the Antarctic Treaty but don't have active science programs and therefore aren't involved in decision making in Antarctica. So the Antarctic Treaty's gone from a small group of 12 countries to 54 signatories, 29 consultative parties, I think I've got that right, the last one being the Czech Republic. And the last signatory, which is very interesting for geopolitical and regional interests, the last two signatories, Malaysia and Pakistan. The Antarctic Treaty is often criticised by academics for being a small club. But in fact, the Antarctic Treaty covers much more than half of the global population, as shown on that map there. And the Antarctic Treaty is open to any member of the United Nations. So any member of the United Nations can join the Antarctic Treaty. It has no veto on signatories. Now, the Antarctic Treaty is as a political and international instrument, is very, very important to Australia because it does one significantly, strategically significant thing. It makes all of that region below 60 degrees south, below Australia, but all around the Antarctic continent and Antarctica itself, from 60 degrees south, is demilitarized. It's nuclear weapons free. And because of that, Australia can, as Roger said, be a two ocean navy and not concentrate that much, at least in a direct military sense, in a defence fighting sense, on the Southern Ocean and Antarctica. We do have strategic interests there, and some of those some of those may require assets, but not for fighting wars. That was really important in that Cold War period, and it's going to become increasingly important in years to come. The fact that Antarctica is demilitarized will be hugely significant in the next 10, 20, 30, 50 years and beyond. The Antarctic Treaty has a number of other articles to it, but the two most important are that there is free exchange of scientific information in Antarctic research, and that the interests of the claimant states are protected by Article 4 of the Antarctic Treaty. That is, the treaty does not dismiss Antarctic claims. It doesn't recognise Antarctic claims either. It recognises that some countries, and they are Russia, and the Soviet Union as it was, Russia, and the United States, assert the rights to claim any or all of Antarctica, and it also protects the interests of those countries that don't recognise any Antarctic claims. And what the Antarctic Treaty did, which was really important, is that it set aside those arguments about territoriality in Antarctica. It didn't set aside the claims, as some academics assert. It set aside the arguments about the claims. And so the Antarctic Treaty, in that sense, is also really important for Australia and others, because it protects Australia's Antarctic claim. In the 80s, there were a number of reports to government about Australia's Antarctic interests and how they should be expressed. And in 1989, the government defined explicitly what Australia's Antarctic policy interests were, and they are to preserve sovereignty over the Australian Antarctic Territory, to maintain Antarctica free from strategic and/or political confrontation, to protect the Antarctic environment, to take advantage of Antarctica's opportunities for science and research, to be informed about and be able to influence developments in a region proximity to Australia, and to derive any reasonable economic benefits from living and non-living resources in the Antarctic Treaty area, excluding mining. And that's because Australia had just led a major international, along with France and the assistance of Spain, major international effort to abandon the Minerals Convention, which had been negotiated, and to put in its place a comprehensive environmental protocol to Antarctica. Now, successive governments since 19, 89 have reasserted those interests, but they're not publicly very well known. And one of the recommendations that I'm making in my report is, in fact, that the government explicitly come out and make these known. I've also recommended there be an additional interest, and that is an interest that Australia protects the Antarctic Treaty System. We'll see where that goes, but I think it's important that Australia sees, that the Australian population sees explicitly what governments have decided about our interests in the Antarctic. In 1998, the last time, 1998, the last time the government actually had a comprehensive look at what we were doing in Antarctica, it's established a number of goals for the Australian Antarctic Program: maintain the Antarctic Treaty System and enhance Australia's influence in it, protect the Antarctic environment, understand the role of Antarctica in the global climate system, and undertake scientific work of practical, economic, and national significance. And I think those goals are as relevant today as they were in 1998. They're not that different from William Clinton's signature to this policy that the Americans have about their Antarctic interests, although Australia's interests are fairly explicitly to do with its territorial claim as well. But protecting the unspoiled environment, preserving and pursuing scientific research, maintaining Antarctica as an area of international cooperation for peaceful purposes, etc. So, the US, Australia, many other countries have got specific statements about their Antarctic interests that are along those lines, and they're consistent with their obligations under the Antarctic Treaty. So, in context, I always try and summarise our view of Antarctica. And there's Australia looking from the bottom of Antarctica. Antarctica is close to Australia. It's peaceful. It's safe. We have very deep historical connections to the Antarctic. It's economically important to us, one of our most profitable fisheries. One of Australia's most profitable fisheries is the toothfish fishery, the Antarctic toothfish fishery. It's actually the Patagonian toothfish fishery, but in sub-Antarctic waters, I caught that. Antarctica is important for Australia, and it's important for science. And I'll get onto science in a minute. Australia's a claimant. We're an original signatory to the Antarctic Treaty. We're a very important player in Antarctic affairs, and we have our own strategic Antarctic interests. So we should be actively engaged in Antarctica, and we should not deliberately or accidentally disengage from Antarctic affairs. So, science. Well, one of my first recommendations in the report I had to modify because of the recent decision by the government to fund the replacement of Aurora Australis. But Australia's one of Australia's very, very few blue water marine research vessels, the icebreaker Aurora Australis, is coming to the end of its life. And in the last budget, the government has committed to replacing that vessel. That will be a very, very, very big project. But it's important For Australia and for those countries that we work with in East Antarctica, for Australia to have comprehensive access to the Antarctic continent from the sea and be able to undertake scientific research in the Southern Ocean, in the sea ice, and along the coast of Antarctica, not only for ourselves, but for assisting other Antarctic countries to also work in Antarctica. So that's a major strategically important decision about our efforts in the Antarctic. That new vessel is scheduled to come online 2019, I think. It's in the tender process at the moment. But leaving aside our territorial claims, leaving aside our historical interests in the Antarctic, leaving aside our physical strategic interests in the Antarctic, I assert that we should and would and must be engaged in Antarctic science, even if any of those other things didn't matter. And that's because Antarctica is hugely important in the global climate system, and we know very, very, very little about Antarctica. This map here on the left-hand side is looking through the ice at the bedrock of East Antarctica, the Australian Antarctic Territory. Those lines are lines flown from an aircraft doing geophysical survey. And what that shows you is, okay, here's the coastline there, the white bits are water, the dark bits are above sea level. The darker they are, the more above sea level they are. The bluer they are, the more below sea level they are. And what that shows is that there's this huge area of East Antarctica, about a third of East Antarctica, is actually grounded below sea level. And we didn't know that 5 years ago. This is research that's being published, that's been published or being published in the last few years. And if you look at it another way, that's what it would look like if you were looking at it at ground level from looking at the mountains below the ice. Now that might be a cute bit of geology, but it's also really important because ice grounded below sea level will contribute to sea level rise, because when water's warm and the sea melts that ice underneath, it retreats, and it will keep retreating until it hits rock. If the coastline was here, then that's where the ice melt would stop, but it's not. The coastline's hundreds of kilometres inland. What we didn't know is, what we didn't know 10 years ago, what we didn't know 5 years ago, is that there is a potential for rapid destabilisation of parts of East Antarctica and a contribution to sea level rise comparable to what we're observing at the moment in West Antarctica and around the Antarctic Peninsula. Antarctica is also important because it gives us a unique view of past climate. We can now go back through the ice cores in Antarctica and get a climate record that goes back to 860,000 years, which is the oldest climate record so far. And there's a national consortium that Australia's involved in, there'll be an international meeting in Hobart early next year, where we'll be looking for ice that's more than a million years old. And this is really important because the general climate cycles that we've been involved in over the last 900, 1.1 million years have been about 140,000 years apart between warming and cooling and warming and cooling. Before that, it was about 40,000 years apart. And we're looking to find an ice core record that goes back to that 40,000 year cycle to see whether that's directly related to conditions in the atmosphere, particularly carbon dioxide. Australia has, in the Australian Antarctic Territory, a place called Law Dome, the very, very, very best temperature records for Antarctica over the last 2,000 years. And so there's a lot we can learn. And from this temperature record at Law Dome, one of the things that we've discovered in the last decade and are still discovering are the teleconnections between climate in Australia and climate in Antarctica. And we know now that, for instance, the drought that's been happening in southwest Western Australia for the last 30 years is actually the biggest drought in the last 800 years. We're able to tell that because when it snows heavily at Law Dome, it's dry in southwestern Western Australia, and you can go back through the record and reconstruct southwestern Western Australia's climate record from the ice in Antarctica. And we're now finding those same kinds of climate records for the Murray-Darling Basin and eastern Australia. So there's much we can learn about our own economic environment, agricultural economic environment, from that kind of research in the Antarctic. And that's why I say that we'd be there anyway. We'd be in Antarctica anyway, even if we didn't have those Antarctic territorial claims. So, I'm not going to questions yet. What does the future hold? Well, Antarctica, I think, will remain for many, many, many decades to come a place of science, peace, and cooperation. I don't think there is any threat to that at all. There's often speculation in the media about the interests of some countries. Russia's often named, others are named, about their interests in mineral resources in the Antarctic. And I think it is true that some countries are being less than transparent in the way they conduct some of their science in Antarctica. And I think that's actually an issue that needs to be addressed politically and diplomatically. But I don't think the ultimate result of that will be opening of mining in Antarctica, at least in the next numbers of decades. It's often said that the Antarctic Treaty expires in 2048, or the ban on mining expires in 2048, and then there'll be a free-for-all in the Antarctic. Well, that's not correct either. The ban on mining in the Antarctic is indefinite, it's perpetual, The only thing that happens, or could happen, is that there could be a review of that, of all of the Madrid Protocol and the ban on mining in 2048, if anybody called for that review. But the mathematics of overturning the mining ban are absolutely formidable. And it would require, ultimately, every country that was a signatory to the Antarctic Treaty in 1990, it would require every one of those countries to agree. If one country didn't agree and didn't enact the requirements for overturning the ban, then the ban would remain in place. What might happen at that stage would be a destabilization of the polity of the political structures in the Antarctic Treaty System, but I doubt that. I think the strength of the Antarctic Treaty has been that it's weathered many political storms and come through them stronger than before those storms commenced. I think the most likely area of conflict in Antarctica is actually in the Southern Ocean for marine living resources. And there are potential marine living resources in Antarctica that are hugely underexploited. The krill fishery is one of them. The krill fishery is the largest underexploited fishery in the world. It has a sustainable yield of somewhere, I mean, a very conservative sustainable yield of somewhere over 4 million tonnes a year. And it's currently being harvested at about 200,000 tonnes a year. So there's a huge potential for expansion of the krill fishery before this conflict. I think that destabilization in that marine living resources area is more likely to come from countries either within or without of the Antarctic Treaty, not abiding by the regulations put down by the Commission for the Conservation of Antarctic Marine Living Resources. So my view is that threats over living resources, conflict over living resources, is going to be more likely and probably occur well before conflict over mineral resources in the Antarctic. I don't see other regional conflicts spilling over in more than a symbolic way into the Antarctic Treaty System. The Russians and the Americans were able to talk to each other all through the Cold War in the Antarctic Treaty. UK and Argentina were able to talk to each other while they were throwing rocks in the conflict over Islas Malvinas, Falkland Islands. I think that it's unlikely that other wider geopolitical interests, conflicts will spill over into the Antarctic, more than symbolically, spill over to the Antarctic environment. I'd be interested, I will be a casual observer in seeing how Ukraine and Russia deal with fishing at the next Kamalai meeting. I'd like to be a fly on the wall for that. But I don't see these things spilling over into deep conflicts within the Antarctic Treaty itself. So let me conclude by saying two things. The first is that Australia should be actively engaged in Antarctica, in science, in governance, and in diplomacy. And we need to match our investment in that engagement with our aspirations. And my personal view is that our aspirations are this big and our investments about that big. And we really need to step up to the plate and invest in the science and the diplomacy that protects our interests. And one of the most important interests to protect in Antarctica is to protect not only our sovereignty, but also the Antarctic Treaty System, because it's through that that Australia's national strategic interests in Antarctica will always be protected. And I'll leave it there.
So, first question here, please.
Patrick Dedeker from ANU, you did not mention the pressures of tourism, and I think they're going to be increasing dramatically, and also who is going to monitor or dictate what can be and what cannot be done.
Okay, I think there are two issues to do with tourism, to put tourism in perspective. Most of the tourism, 97% of tourism, occurs on the Antarctic Peninsula. And the global economic crisis actually knocked the wind out of the sails of tourism. So back before the global economic crisis, tourism numbers in Antarctica were about 40,000 a year. And as I said, 97% going to the Antarctic Peninsula. But of those, around about 90% of those actually were vessel-based. So they never, they were never on land more than for the occasional visit. That doesn't mean that there aren't potential impacts of tourism. And the two biggest potential impacts of tourism are direct degradation of the physical environment, trampling, spreading of disease, introduction of alien organisms. The other effect of tourism are the unforeseen accidents, where you get a vessel hold and an environmental disaster ensuing. We almost saw one of those this year down in Antarctica from a group of tourists calling themselves the Australian Antarctic Expedition. that was a potential situation that never eventuated. So my view is that the level of tourism and the kinds of direct impacts that tourism has can actually be quite easily managed. And they are being managed at the moment through two sets of institutions. One is the Antarctic Treaty itself and the measures that it has in place to regulate tourism, and also by the tourism industry, that has a very, very, more so than anywhere else that I've been involved in, and for those that have known me for a long time, I've been engaged in natural area management for about 30 years. The level of industry self-regulation in Antarctica far exceeds industry regulation anywhere else. I think that potentially the biggest impact of tourism will be a combination of climate change and accidental introduction of alien organisms. In other words, climate change making it parts of Antarctica, particularly the peninsula, more hospitable to alien organisms, and tourism bringing in an organism that establishes there. But that's a lot less likely than national Antarctic programs doing the same thing. And so the same efforts and regulations that apply to the tourism industry need to be applied to national Antarctic programs as well to stop that happening.
Rupert Somerson from, I'll say, the University of Melbourne. You mentioned that the one of your recommendations is going to be strengthening the protection of the Antarctic Treaty System itself. Would that include strengthening the Madrid Protocol and some of the measures that it introduced, such as the protected area system? The Madrid Protocol was came into force 16 years ago, and protected area system under Annex 5 has essentially languished. Nothing much happened.
I'm a little. My recommendation's a little more general than that. What I'm actually recommending is that Australia publicly commit to supporting the Antarctic Treaty System as part of its national interest. But in a general sense, I think one of the most underdeveloped parts of the Madrid Protocol since it came into force in 1998 is the protected area system. And I do believe that international efforts are needed to and expand the area protection regime in Antarctica. You may be interested in having a look at the article that Valeri Lukin just published on area protection in Antarctica and why it's a plot by the claimant states to undermine the Antarctic Treaty System. It's quite a read, but I'll leave that for you.
If a country carries out some activities in off-treating Antarctic territory, such as building a scientific station or carrying out other scientific activities or even other activities for resources, will these activities have an influence on off-treating interests or influence off-treating claim for Antarctic?
Okay, there are many levels to that question. But the first is that under the Antarctic Treaty, all of Antarctica is available to all countries that are members of the treaty to engage in scientific activity. So Australia doesn't impose laws on foreign nationals in Antarctica, in the Australian Antarctic Territory. That's one of the practices that's grown up in the Antarctic Treaty because of that overriding obligation in the Antarctic Treaty for free access to any or all of Antarctica for scientific research. So at that level, there's no conflict between Australia saying we have the Australian Antarctic Territory and another country, France or India or Russia or China, conducting scientific activities there. You mentioned resources. Well, any country exploiting mineral resources in Antarctica would be in breach of the Antarctic Treaty. And then you may or may not have implied, do those activities actually change the status of the Australian Antarctic Territory? Well, no. Article 4 of the Australian Antarctic Article 4 of the Antarctic Treaty says that anything that happens within the life of the treaty in Antarctica neither affirms or diminishes territorial claims.
Thank you.
Harvey March at sometime ANU. Tony, getting people to and from Antarctica is always a problem. You talked about the replacement of the Aurora Australis. There's also the air transport system, which hasn't been as successful as it could be, flying to the ice runway at Casey because of the melt there. In your strategic plan, do you see the development of a more substantial rock runway, say in the Vestfold Hills, for example, that would enable the transfer of both people and also the potential for some cargo to Antarctica?
Right. What I've recommended is that we should do a thorough review of the current availability for air transport systems to and from Antarctica. And there are now platforms that are available to fly that distance and with the right engine and ETOPS configurations to be able to operate under an Australian license to and from Antarctica. When the ice runway was put in place, there were a very limited number of aircraft that could do that and do it successfully. There are now at least one, if not two, aircraft that are at least capable of doing that. My recommendation is that the government should look at that in the medium term and to try and configure an air transport system that would allow for direct flights to and from more than just one place in Antarctica. I haven't been so bold as to say there should be a rock runway here or an ice runway there. I think there's a lot more ice to flow around the continent before somebody comes to that decision. But one of the things I will say is that Australia will not be able to maximise the potential that the new research vessel gives it unless it also matches that potential with greater capability for inter- and intra-continental air transport.
Thank you, Tony. John McFarlane from the Strategic Defence Studies at the ANU. This question may be outside the scope of the talk, so it will be released. But some years ago, an Australian customs vessel intercepted or tried to intercept, I think it was a Spanish vessel.
The Viasa.
Yeah. On trying to fish or fishing for packing to fish. And then it chased this vessel all the way to South Africa, where it was ultimately arrested. The crew members were extradited to Australia. They were tried before the Western Australian Supreme Court and acquitted. And I understand that the reason for the acquittal was that our law was inadequate in this area. So I just wondered if any lessons have been learned from that, and in particular, has our law been updated so that we don't have this fiasco happening again?
Short answer is yes. What it was to do was not really about Antarctica, it was that vessel. Was sighted in the Australian Exclusive Economic Zone around Heard Island. And it was the way the vessel was intercepted that led to that rather unfortunate overturning of, well, the lack of conviction. So, yes, the law and the practice has been changed. But that's still the longest pursuit ever on the high seas. And there are some fantastic photographs of the... it was actually boarded by South African fisheries enforcement officers, who were the scariest bunch of people I've ever seen. They looked as if they'd just walked out of Angola. It was fantastic. Anyway, it was a tragedy to lose that case.
Martin,
thank you. I'm Liz Plakatica from Strategic and Defence Studies Centre. So the ATS is negotiated, obviously, in a different time With the rise of new technology, how do you think Australia is going to deal with, say, space-based surveillance and satellite, which could be classified as peaceful but then serves a military purpose through, say, intel collection?
That's interesting. I've actually been asked that question a number of times. And I've actually talked around a few people about that. There are better places, you know, in the world to put ground stations to listen to the rest of the world than Antarctica. And the short answer is that practically Antarctica probably won't become a great hub for that kind of activity. It has been speculated. I do think, though, that at some stage in the future, inside the Antarctic Treaty itself, there needs to be a discussion about non-traditional military engagement. You know, I think we can work out ships and guns and bombs and all that kind of stuff. But at some stage in the future, there'll need to be a fairly explicit discussion about what people actually do in the area of satellite technology and surveillance. India, for instance, I know is really interested in setting up geostationary satellites over the Indian Ocean. And whether they're stationed in Antarctica or is associated with that kind of activity, I just don't know that.
How long would it be before we would have trouble in the next 20 years?
Sorry. Oh, look, if you mothballed any of our stations in Antarctica without establishing a comparable effort somewhere else, and I don't mean build a station, I mean revamp your science program or go drill the million-year-old ice core in the Aurora Basin. If all you did was mothball and walk away, in a strict treaty sense, that wouldn't do anything to Australia's Antarctic claim, but it would certainly be seen by the rest of the world as Australia losing its interest in its Antarctic territory. And that would be something that Australia could never recover from.
Thank you, Bruce Cook. Thanks. From time to time, we hear murmurings that the US are going to pull out of Christchurch, probably predominated by earthquakes. Do you see opportunities for other nations facing themselves on Australia, and particularly in Tasmania?
Well, let's go to the US. I don't think the US will ever pull out of Christchurch. The relationship between the US, New Zealand, Antarctica, and the New Zealand ban on nuclear vessels are very tightly interwoven, and I don't see the US diminishing its efforts in Christchurch, but I do see opportunities for Hobart to actually host US activities from time to time. And as a matter of fact, this year there are, I think, six US research visits to the Port of Hobart. And I see in the future, with the upgrade of the extension to the Hobart runway, I see US aircraft being able to, say, do a run Guam, Alice Springs, Hobart, McMurdo, that kind of thing, the heavy lift aircraft. Australia itself flies a lot of US scientific personnel to and from Christchurch to McMurdo. They could also do that from Hobart to McMurdo as well. Australia's got a quid pro quo. Looking at other nations, Australia has had a very, very long and deep association with the Chinese Antarctic effort. The Chinese scientists, the first Chinese scientist to go to Antarctica, came to Antarctica with the Australian Antarctic Division. And Australia has deep personal and scientific connections with Chinese scientists. And there is still much engagement in the Chinese science program and the Australian Antarctic program working together. And I see potentially a lot more activity between Australia and China operating out of Hobart. And then other countries like Korea and Russia are also possible occasional or regular users of the port of Hobart and the airport at Hobart. With the extension of the Hobart runway, you can actually fly direct from Shanghai to Hobart, for example. I see there's a lot of potential there. I don't think you'll see India. India's got a special presidential decree that says they'll operate out of Cape Town. But I think there's an opportunity for more effort from other nations operating out of Hobart. And I've actually done a fairly detailed economic analysis of the relationship between the Antarctic program and the Tasmanian economy. If you want to know the Antarctic and marine science efforts in Tasmania are now about the same size as forestry. So they're a significant part of the Tasmanian economy.
Given the relationship between Panama and the Antarctic Treaty and the potential for conflict and destabilisation associated with access to marine resources, I was wondering whether or not you might reflect on whether or not there should be perhaps a greater investment or a primary investment, strategic investment in marine science versus investment in land-based Antarctic science.
Oh, look, absolutely. The examples that I used there were examples. I think there's... I don't think we should... Australia and others, as a matter of fact, should diminish at all their marine science efforts in the Southern Ocean. I was commenting today that Switzerland has twice as much marine science capability as Australia has. I think that we need, and so does New Zealand. I think that we need to ramp up our efforts in all areas of marine science in the Antarctic, not just physical but biological as well. And there's actually one of the great international efforts that Australia led, which was the census of Antarctic marine life. That's about to be launched. That book's about to be launched in today, is it?
2 weeks ago.
Yeah, I know it was launched at Scarborough, but it's launched again in Australia tomorrow or today or something. Anyway, multiple launches. But yes, I don't think we should diminish our efforts at all. I think we should increase our efforts.
Sean Clark, New Zealand. Tony, thanks very much for a wonderful presentation. One would assume there's still vulnerabilities with the Antarctic Treaty System, that for as long as there are the existing ambiguities around the management and sharing of global commons, and there are 60% of the world's nations not signatory or consultative party to the treaty. So we'll be looking to drive for as much interest in the treaty as possible. How's progress and what are the obstacles to the rest of the countries joining the treaty system?
Okay, so after the 25th anniversary of the coming into force of the Madrid Protocol, Australia, France and others led a concerted diplomatic effort to get more parties to sign up to the Madrid Protocol, which of course necessitates signing the treaty, not necessarily necessitates signing the Kamala Convention. I think things will probably stay relatively stable for the next few years. My suspicion is that this misunderstanding about the expiry of the mining ban, and I will reinforce the mining ban does not expire, it continues forever unless overturned, but that misunderstanding might actually lead to more parties becoming interested in joining the Antarctic Treaty as 2048 as 2048 approaches. And one of the recommendations I've made in my report is, in fact, Australia and others and the Antarctic Treaty parties as a whole should be actively going out there explaining what the treaty does, what the Environmental Protection Protocol does, what CAMELAR does, and engaging with non-parties.